happening? How you guys doing? Love it, love it, love it. This is such a cool event. I'm so excited to be here. My name is Max Lugavere, and just to give you a brief overview in case you're unfamiliar with my work, I wrote a book that came out in 2018 called Genius Foods. Has anybody read it? Anybody familiar? Handful of people. Okay, cool. So the book came out in 2018. It's sort of like a nutritional care manual for the human brain. Explores the link between diet and lifestyle and brain health with a specific focus on the burgeoning field of dementia prevention, a topic that I'm extremely passionate about. I'll tell you more about that. And then I've written two subsequent books. The Genius Life came out March 2020. Not the best time to put out a book. And then it's the middle child, you know, love it dearly. And then Genius Kitchen came out last year, and it's sort of like a wellness manual and cookbook. I do a lot of advocacy and science communication. I got to go on major TV shows, The Rachel Ray Show, The Dr. Oz Show. I was very lucky. I did a tiny podcast called The Joe Rogan Experience last year. One of my proudest accomplishments, actually, if you draw your attention to the lower middle portion of the screen, I don't just write for lay audiences. I've gotten to co-author a chapter in a textbook for clinicians describing the science as it currently stands with regard to the clinical practice of dementia prevention, which is super exciting. Actually getting to change the way physicians practice medicine with regard to preventative neurology. And then finally, I host a podcast called The Genius Life, which is sort of my pride and joy. I love it. We put up two episodes a week, very fun. But I'm not a medical doctor. I didn't go down the academic path. I'm a health and science journalist. And the reason that I decided to focus my life on evangelizing for the role of diet and lifestyle in optimizing cognitive health is that at a very young age, my mother, Kathy, who you see here, developed a rare form of dementia called Lewy body dementia, a progressive, incurable condition that feels almost like having Alzheimer's disease and Parkinson's disease at the same time. Has anybody heard of Lewy body dementia? Yeah, it's a terrible condition, and it was fairly recently revealed that it was actually what Robin Williams was suffering from. And dementia is a major problem. I just got back from London, and it turns out that dementia and Alzheimer's disease is actually the number one cause of death there now. And so it's a heartbreaking condition. Nobody's ever survived it. And the science suggests that, like many of the chronic non-communicable diseases of modernity that people are now suffering from, these conditions don't begin overnight. They begin decades sometimes before the presentation of symptoms. And this is indeed the case for Alzheimer's disease, which is the most common form of dementia. It begins in the brain 30 to 40 years before the first symptom. So the time to start thinking about your brain health is now, which is why I'm super excited to talk to people of all ages, but particularly younger people. Now, with my mom, I experienced what I've come to call diagnose and adios in every clinician's office. A doctor would run a battery of esoteric tests, and it left me very disillusioned as to the power of, or as to the role of medicine with regard to these conditions for which we have such immense windows of opportunity to change our destinies, or to at least influence our destinies. And so when my mom became sick, as a journalist, I started investigating why this would have happened to a woman, and why indeed it's happening to so many people around the world now. And I started to explore modern life and ask questions like, what is it about the modern world that seems to be pulling the trigger for so many of our genetic predispositions, leading to such rampant rates of obesity, of type 2 diabetes, of cardiovascular disease, and of course, dementia? Now, when you look around the average supermarket, so this is like a picture of your average supermarket, right? In the aisles of, most supermarkets are designed the same way. Around the perimeter, you find the fresh, perishable foods, but the aisles are typically where you find what are now being referred to by nutrition researchers as ultra-processed foods. These are the shelf-stable, packaged processed foods that Americans now overconsume. 60% of the calories that your average American consumes now comes from what are called ultra-processed foods. And in fact, very new research used machine learning technology to come to the conclusion that over 73% of the US food supply is ultra-processed. These foods are highly calorie dense. They tend to possess a quality known as hyperpalatability. They push your brain to a bliss point beyond which self-control is essentially futile. If any of you guys have ever had the experience of opening up a pint of ice cream, intending only to have like a spoonful, and before you know it, you're looking at the bottom of the pint. Has anyone had that experience? I mean, I have. We tend to think of that phenomena as a moral failure, right? Like, why couldn't I moderate my consumption of the ice cream or the tortilla chips or the crisps or whatever you want to call them, right? But it's not a moral failure at all. That's our brains and bodies doing exactly what they were designed to do, and food manufacturers know this. That's why we become repeat customers. So this is actually, there was a wonderful photo essay performed by, or created by a photojournalist, looking at the average grocery haul of families around the world. And this is a British family. And so this is like a week's worth of groceries for your average British family. I actually just got back from London. 3 days ago I was in London, which was amazing. And it is very difficult to find really high quality fresh food, you know? People just tend to love these ultra-processed foods. And if you like look at this photo, you have to squint almost to find the fresh food. It's not much different for your average American family. So again, an overabundance of ultra-processed foods, hyper-palatable, calorie-dense, typically nutrient-poor ultra-processed foods. And these are the kinds of foods that we are now, you know, our diets have become saturated with. Unfortunately, we see that ultra-processed foods food consumption is clearly associated with cardiovascular disease, including hypertension, which I'm going to come back to, all-cause mortality, overweight and obesity, cancers, depression, and yes, even dementia. In fact, this is new research showing us a dose response. For every 10% increment in ultra-processed food consumption, we see an increased risk of the development of dementia by about 25%. So every 10% increase in ultra-processed food consumption, one's relative risk of dementia increases by 25%. Now, as I mentioned, so one of the, there are many nefarious aspects of these foods, but one of the consequences of over-consuming them is that they tend to drive up blood pressure to the point that now 50% of adults have hypertension, aka high blood pressure. Hypertension is a major problem. Adolescents are now developing it. Children are now developing it. But 50% of adults now have it. And in one of the seminal works in the field of dementia prevention, we see that having high blood pressure chronically directly damages the brain. It damages the 400 miles of estimated microvasculature that supply blood and nutrients and oxygen and antioxidants to the brain. So this was a seminal paper that found that when people were pharmacologically treated, so with drugs, mind you, for their hypertension aggressively, they saw a 20% risk reduction for the development of what's called mild cognitive impairment. Mild cognitive impairment is pre-dementia. So a lot of people will develop mild cognitive impairment before they develop full-blown Alzheimer's disease. But here's the magic of this insight. So even though this study used drugs, we can easily affect our blood pressure with diet and lifestyle modifications. This is why this research was so exciting. So foods for flourishing, right? One of my favorite foods and a food that I talk a lot about are dark leafy greens. Dark leafy greens, kale, arugula, spinach, romaine lettuce, it doesn't really matter which type of dark leafy green you most enjoy, but one of the most beneficial aspects of dark leafy greens is that they provide compounds called nitrates, natural nitrates. Many people might be, especially those that are, have been interested in fitness for some time, might be familiar with the role that beets and beetroot extract can, you know, boost what's called nitric oxide in our blood vessels, which is a gas that increases blood flow, reduces blood pressure. Well, dark leafy greens actually are one of the most cardioprotective foods in the produce department of the supermarket. And actually, research suggests that people who eat a large bowl of dark leafy greens every day have brains that perform up to 11 years younger. So this is a correlational finding, it's not necessarily causal, but when we look to the potential mechanisms that might explain this observation, it makes perfect sense, because among their characteristics, dark leafy greens are rich in nitrates, which bacteria in our mouths convert to nitrite, so they reduce nitrate to nitrite, which is the compound that then enters the nitric oxide pathway, boosting blood flow up to the brain, all around the body, reducing blood pressure. And we can see that in clinical trials, that the consumption of nitrate-rich foods, like dark leafy greens, actually boost blood flow to the part of the brain associated with executive function. So if you want to have greater, more, you know, agency in the world, if you want to be more effective in life, perform at your best, right? Executive function is literally like how we get stuff done, decision-making, planning, impulse control, attentional control. Then boosting blood flow to that region of the brain, the prefrontal cortex, it's win-win. And here we see in the lower half of the screen, we see that one single high nitrate meal might be sufficient to boost cognitive function. So powerful role that dark leafy greens can play in boosting blood flow, helping to reduce blood pressure, and keep us healthy. Absolutely incredible. However, about 40% of Americans today use antiseptic mouthwash on a regular basis. Does anybody here use mouthwash frequently? Okay, so the problem with antiseptic mouthwash is that it destroys the bacteria in your mouth that are responsible for that conversion of nitrate to nitrite. Remember, bacteria on our tongues actually convert nitrate, found in dark leafy greens and beets, to nitrite, which then lowers blood pressure. So when we indiscriminately nuke the bacteria in our mouths, it actually negates, or at least attenuates, the ability for us to derive a cardioprotective benefit from foods like dark leafy greens. In fact, we see research that suggests that people who frequently use antiseptic mouthwash have a 50% increased risk for the development of type 2 diabetes and a doubling of risk for the development of hypertension. Now, more research is needed. This population was already pretty unwell at the onset. But we can also see mechanistically in clinical trials, so randomized controlled trials, the kinds of trials required to prove cause and effect, that when people swish with antiseptic mouthwash in the post-exercise setting, one of the most amazing things about exercise is that it can reduce blood pressure, that some of the anti-hypertensive effects of exercise are actually negated. So occasional use of antiseptic mouthwash for medical purposes, fine, but you definitely don't want to be using this every day. Another aspect of dark leafy greens that I think are incredible is that they are the richest source of compounds called carotenoids. Now, anybody with a genetic risk factor for, say, age-related macular degeneration might be familiar with these two compounds, lutein and zeaxanthin, because if you look at any eye health supplement in the supermarket or drugstore, you're typically gonna see lutein and zeaxanthin. We've known for decades that these two compounds at a dose of around 12 milligrams a day can actually help prevent age-related macular degeneration. Kale is the top source. In a one cup of cooked kale, you get about 24 milligrams of combined lutein and zeaxanthin. But we now are starting to see that eyes are not just a window to the brain, they're an extension of the brain. Our eyes contain neural tissue. And these same compounds that aggregate in the macula and protect it as we age also accumulate in the brain, where they protect our brain cells. It's amazing, they protect our brain cells, and not only that, but they actually improve the way that our brains work. So here are a handful of studies, if you'd like to look at this a little bit further, But we see that people who consume more lutein and zeaxanthin, and in fact have more lutein and zeaxanthin in their maculas, so that's actually something very easy to observe, and we believe that it's correlated to the amount in our neural tissue as well, actually seem to have some degree of protection against cognitive decline. And if you look on the lower half of the screen, this was an RCT performed out of University of Georgia using young and healthy college students, which is always an exciting cohort for researchers to tap into because, you know, college students are already thought to be at the peak of their cognitive prowess, right? So if we can find a compound that actually, you know, from food that has a nootropic effect and can actually boost the way cognitive function works in the young and healthy, I mean, that's pretty miraculous. And here in this study, they found that supplementing with about 34 milligrams of lutein and zeaxanthin a day actually boosted neural efficiency and visual processing speed. Now, neural efficiency is actually a cool concept. So what is neural efficiency? It seems that brighter individuals show lower brain activation than less bright individuals when working on the same cognitive task. So basically, your brain needs to do less work to achieve the same task if you have increased neural efficiency. And again, lutein and zeaxanthin have been shown to boost neural efficiency in the brain. Dark leafy greens, a top source. Now, I will add the caveat, while you're striving to get your large bowl of dark leafy greens every day, as I mentioned, that's the Rush University observation, that people who do that have more youthful brains with regard to cognitive performance. These are fat-soluble compounds, so you always want to consume them with a fat source. I'm a huge fan of extra virgin olive oil. I'm going to explain why shortly. But if you're consuming a fat source with your salad, with your greens, that's more than adequate to ensure that you are maximally absorbing and utilizing these important compounds, lutein and zeaxanthin. So that's why I'm a huge fan of dark leafy greens. And we live in a time now, a lot of people are on carnivore diets and they eschew dark leafy greens, but I continue to be a massive fan. Now, every person's gonna have differing tolerances to various, you know, plant materials, but in general, these are all great foods. Very nutrient-dense foods. So another food that I am a massive fan of, another food for flourishing, if you will, eggs. So eggs have been demonized for decades at this point, really taking a beating, no pun intended. But that's unfortunate because egg yolks contain a little bit of everything that Mother Nature has deemed important to grow a brain. Rich source of a compound called choline, which helps to, it provides the precursor molecule to your brain cell membranes. It also provides the precursor to acetylcholine, which is an important neurotransmitter, important for learning and memory. It contains vitamin B12 in abundance. And an egg yolk contains cholesterol. Now, you don't need to consume dietary cholesterol for good brain health. Your brain produces all of the cholesterol that it needs in a process called de novo cholesterol synthesis. But it's no wonder that an egg yolk is a rich source of dietary cholesterol because the brain is a rich repository of cholesterol. 25% of the cholesterol in your body is accounted for by your brain, which makes up only 2-3% of your body's mass. So again, egg yolks are like a cognitive multivitamin. I'm a huge fan. Here we see that consumption of choline in men, but regardless of the most well-defined dementia risk factor, genetic risk factor, the APOE4 allele, higher intake of choline was associated over 22 years with a 30% risk reduction for the development of dementia. Now, I think that this study is really interesting because plants and animals, plant foods and animal source foods, all contain choline. But animal source foods are the richest source. Beef liver is like the richest known source, followed by egg yolks. And then beef, chicken, all contain a fair amount of choline. And then you get a little bit of choline in cruciferous vegetables, but the concentration is way lower. So if you actually use choline as a proxy for animal foods, there's been this demonization of animal foods over the past few decades, along with egg yolks, of course. And right here, I mean, what this evidence seems to suggest is that animal foods provide a very protective role in brain health. So I'm a huge fan. I think a very balanced approach. I'm a big fan of whole plants as well as animal source foods. And one of, I think, the most underappreciated but important aspects of animal source foods is that they are the best source of protein there is. I mean, we can look at various indices of measures of protein quality. There are a few measures that are now used to assess protein digestibility. We can also look at the amino acid profile of animal proteins, and they are superior, simply put, to plant proteins. Soy is fairly digestible, relative to other plant source proteins, but by and large, animal source protein is plug and play to the human body in an amino acid ratio that makes perfect sense from the standpoint of our biology. Now, frailty, also known as sarcopenia, is a major risk factor we're starting to see for not just dementia, cognitive decline, but other diseases of aging. You want to make sure that you are robust. You maintain a degree of robustness and resilience as you age. Our dietary guidelines are insufficient, research is starting to show. They haven't changed for decades. But we're now starting to see that higher levels of protein intake beyond what the RDA suggests that Americans consume every day actually helps to optimize our bodies. And we're starting to see also the role that this robustness and resilience plays in long-term cognitive health. So the current RDA for protein is 0.8 grams per kilogram of body weight. For non-exercising individuals who just want to fight off frailty, the data suggests that 1.2 is a more optimal threshold, so about 1.5 times what the RDA is. But if you're exercising, which you should be, the optimal amount of protein that you should be consuming on a daily basis is actually double what the RDA is, so about 1.6 grams per kilogram of body weight. If you want to, I don't know why we still continue to use kilograms here with regard to our dietary recommendations, but it's about 0.7 grams of protein per pound of body weight, if you will. So you could just do the math, multiply your weight by 0.7. That's how many grams of protein you should be getting on a daily basis, assuming that you're exercising. There's been a lot of associations made between meat consumption and poor health outcomes. But most of our nutritional dietary guidelines are based on what are called epidemiologic studies. So looking at the population level, looking at the types of meat that people eat, the quantity of meat that people eat, and then looking at associations with how their health fares over time. But these studies are always vulnerable to a form of bias called healthy user bias. And because meat and eggs have been so heavily demonized over the past few decades, we tend to see, I mean, that's just one reason, but we do tend to see that people who eat more meat tend to adhere to other lifestyle habits that are not so great. So they tend to be more likely to smoke, they're more likely to be sedentary. This is called healthy user bias. So we tend to see at the observational population level that meat consumption is typically associated with poor health outcomes. But as we get better at doing this kind of research, we see that actually it's really weak data, to suggest that meat is not great for us. And in fact, new research is actually starting to show us that, wait a minute, meat can be just as healthy as long as dietary quality is high and you are generally a health-conscious person. And so, here's just a handful of the latest and greatest studies from an epidemiologic perspective. Again, like epidemiologic observational evidence, it's all fairly weak because, people don't eat just one single food in isolation, right? They consume dietary patterns. But here we have just a sampling of data. I mean, meta-analyses show that meat consumption is associated with lower risk of cognitive impairment. I mean, again, it provides important micronutrients that are plug and play to the body, vitamin B12, zinc, protein, of course. UK Biobank study, which is an ongoing study of 500,000 people, showed that, for a dose response, for every increase in meat consumption, there was a concurrent relative risk reduction for the development of dementia, 30%. And then other systematic reviews and meta-analyses show us that, you know, meat consumption has no association with stroke and other poor health outcomes. So I'm just waiting for the data to show a real health concern with regard to meat. On the other hand, randomized controlled trials have never shown that meat drives any of the poor health outcomes that people tend to be most concerned with. Again, if diet quality is high and meat quality is high, I think it plays an absolutely additive and protective beneficial role. When it comes to brain health specifically, there's little arguing the fact that fish, fatty fish in particular, has a well-documented protective role. It's incredible for pregnant women to consume. We see that the offspring born to pregnant women who consume the most fish tend to have greater cognitive mental abilities in childhood. And we even see that the fatty acids that are contained by fatty fish, people who have more of them in circulation tend to see a pretty remarkable and significant reduced risk for the development of dementia by about 50%. Fatty fish is a great source of omega-3 fatty acids, so DHA fat, aka docosahexaenoic acid. It's one of the most important structural building blocks of the brain. It's plug and play. When we consume it from fatty fish, salmon, for example, sardines, mackerel, herring, our bodies know what to do with those fats. To contrast this with the plant-based omega-3s that you sometimes, you know, will hear about in flax seeds and chia seeds and walnuts and the like, those fatty acids have to go through complex biochemical transformation in order for them to be properly utilized by the body. And those processes differ in terms of their efficacy from person to person. Certain genders are better than others. Certain people with certain genes are better than others. If you want to take the guesswork out of optimizing your nutrition, you really want to get your DHA fat from animal source products. If you do happen to be on a plant-based diet, first question I would ask is why, but algae oil is a great source of DHA fat as well. And so many people on plant-based diets will tend to use algal oil. Another fantastic food for flourishing is extra virgin olive oil. So extra virgin olive oil is one of the hallmark components of the Mediterranean dietary pattern, which is lauded by even the most orthodox of nutrition experts for having the ability to reduce risk for cardiovascular disease, for neurodegenerative disease. Meta-analyses now show us that extra virgin olive oil has a powerful anti-inflammatory effect. In fact, it may share a mechanism with low-dose ibuprofen. So ibuprofen, I'm sure we all have it in our medicine cabinets, I do, is a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, which can be great to use on occasion, but chronic use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs is associated with cardiovascular events and stomach bleeding and the like. Extra virgin olive oil might actually share a mechanism and provide an anti-inflammatory benefit, but with none of the downside. And this is what meta-analyses of randomized controlled trials are now showing us, a reduction in inflammatory biomarkers like C-reactive protein, which, you know, your doctor will measure whenever you get a physical to get a sense of your, you know, your overall inflammation status. The other amazing thing about extra virgin olive oil, particularly in the context of the standard American diet, is that it's not one of these ultra-processed, refined, bleached, and deodorized seed oils. Seed oils have become a popular topic of conversation on social media. Corn oil, canola oil, soybean oil. These oils are the darling of the food industry because they're dirt cheap to produce. They have no flavor profile. They can be used in any number of ultra-processed food products. But we've been using consuming extra virgin olive oil as a culinary oil for almost centuries at this point, because how you make it is you simply crush olives. This is to contrast how these ultra-processed refined bleach and deodorized seed oils are produced. They have to go through myriad industrial processing steps. And if you actually look to the lower portion of the screen, you'll see a step labeled deodorization. So first of all, if a food that you're eating needs to be deodorized, you really ought to ask yourself why you're eating it. But that step in the process, whether or not your canola oil is organic, expeller pressed, deodorization exposes these delicate fats extracted from the food matrix to very high temperatures. And that actually generates harmful trans fats. Our diets used to contain a lot more trans fats back when partially hydrogenated oils were allowed on the market. Those were banned about a decade ago. But trans fats, man-made trans fats, still exist in the food supply by way of these ultra-processed grain and seed oils, which do not possess the anti-inflammatory effect that extra virgin olive oil has, and potentially become mutagenic when heated and reheated, particularly in the restaurant setting. We see that diets that are rich in monounsaturated fat, which is the primary fatty acid type found in extra virgin olive oil, they're lipoproteins. So the particles that circulate in your blood carrying cholesterol and triglycerides seem to be protected from oxidative modification, which is basically like what begins the process that ultimately cascades into atherosclerosis. We see that people who consume more extra virgin olive oil, which is rich in chemically stable monounsaturated fat, they seem to have better cardiovascular health. Nonetheless, we've been told for decades, you know, and lo and behold, you go to the supermarket, you tend to see the Red Heart Healthy logo on these grain and seed oils. Well, this is very interesting. If you guys have heard of the French paradox, raise your hand. The French paradox. So, and how many people have heard of the Israeli paradox? So the Israeli paradox is actually a really interesting phenomenon. So people in Israel, they consume more grain and seed oils than anybody on earth, more than the US by about 10%. They're doing everything right, right? So despite them having one of the highest dietary polyunsaturated fat ratios in the world, they have very high prevalence of cardiovascular disease. And in fact, their number one killer over there is cancer. So correlation isn't causation, but you know, you would think that if these oils were so great for us, as they tend to suggest on their own packaging, that, you know, that you wouldn't see such an effect, right? Now, those oils do lower relative to saturated fats. This is one of the reasons why we've been told to embrace them in our diets. Relative to saturated fats, grain and seed oils will lead to lower levels of LDL cholesterol, right? Which is a biomarker associated with cardiovascular disease. But we have no idea what these oils, the chronic consumption of these oils, are doing to our brains. Our intake of these fats has skyrocketed over the past 50 to 100 years. Because again, they're a product of the food industry, which loves to use them in these ultra-processed foods. Now, don't get me wrong, ultra-processed foods are a problem whether or not they contain grain and seed oils. And most people ought not to hyper-focus on grain and seed oils and instead reduce their consumption of ultra-processed foods. However, I think it is an interesting question to ask. What are these fats doing to our brains? Our brains are made of fat. And so here is a very interesting paper published in 2021 by a researcher out of UC Davis, Amir Taha, who raised very interesting and important questions about the role of these oils and what they're doing to our brains. And it's a very controversial topic. Evidence-based nutrition practitioners, the nutritional and medical orthodoxy still loves these fats. Very controversial topic. Nonetheless, we have massive blind spots in terms of how these fats, when consumed chronically, as your average American is now consuming them, what these types of fats are doing to our brains. Clinical trials show that when people reduce their consumption of these fats, they see reduced frequency of migraines. We see that dietary levels of these fats correlate strongly with levels in breast milk, and that babies born to mothers with higher levels of the fatty acid derivatives from grain and seed oils have worse cognitive, lower cognitive function, lower cognitive abilities in childhood. So we see that these are not necessarily benign to the brain, and so that's why I urge people to reduce their consumption of them. Extra virgin olive oil is the primary oil that I use in my kitchen. You can cook with it. It's a myth that you can't cook with it. You want to make sure that you're getting a really high quality version of it. You want to ensure that it's extra virgin and use it regularly. It's great. Moving on. So I'm a huge fan of dark chocolate. Anybody else? All right. I was wondering, who knows? I love dark chocolate. So we're starting to see now that dark chocolate contains compounds called flavanols that provide a very supportive role in brain health. For one, dark chocolate, cacao, is a rich source of nitrate. So again, it's great for helping reduce risk of hypertension. You just want to make sure that, if you're eating dark chocolate regularly, there's not a lot of added sugar. You generally want to stick to 75% or higher in terms of the cacao content. Wonderful source of magnesium, which is a macro mineral. About 50% of Americans don't consume adequate magnesium, so half the room likely not consuming adequate magnesium. Magnesium is a really important mineral that helps to generate ATP, so energy. It's required for DNA repair enzymes. So DNA damage is one of the root causes of aging. One of the root causes of aging, of cancer. And magnesium might play a protective role. It's also really important for mental health. Magnesium is incredible. Dark chocolate is a phenomenal source. Copper, another mineral that most of us don't consume adequate amounts of. It's actually a food. It's a health food. Most people don't see it as such, but. Now, correlation doesn't equal causation, but there's also a link. Per capita chocolate consumption and Nobel laureates produced by a given country. This is real. Correlation doesn't equal causation, okay? But, if I can use research like this to vindicate my chocolate habit. Right? Another food for flourishing, nuts. Big fan of nuts and seeds, nuts in particular. Great. The food matrix. The food matrix is really important, Whole foods. We gotta eat more whole foods. For as opinionated as I may seem, I don't really care what anybody eats. So long as they opt more for whole foods. And part of the reason that whole foods are so beneficial is that the whole food matrix, we're just now starting to see the impact that the food matrix has on how we digest and assimilate nutrients. And nuts are an amazing example of this. So, take almonds, an amazing source of vitamin E. Vitamin E is one of the most important antioxidants for the brain. Why? Because vitamin E's primary role in nature is to prevent fats from oxidizing. Your brain is made of fat. And not only that, your brain is a crucible for oxidative stress because it accounts for 25% of the oxygen that you breathe, of the energy that you create, in a container the size of a grapefruit. So it's a crucible for oxidative stress, and vitamin E is the most important fat-soluble antioxidant in our diets. So we want to optimize for vitamin E, okay? I'm not saying you need to supplement with it, but foods that contain vitamin E generally are very protective from a brain health standpoint. Almonds, fantastic source of vitamin E, fantastic source of magnesium. In one handful of almonds, you get about 25% of your daily magnesium needs. But going back to the food matrix, so this is brand new research. This has caused food manufacturers to literally rewrite the nutrition facts labels on their foods that include nuts. A USDA study found that nuts have 30% calories on average, so it depends nut to nut and person to person, but about 30% fewer calories than previously thought. But here's the catch, whole nuts. When you chew nuts, and they've done really interesting studies. I actually was just in London before here, where I interviewed the lead researcher on some of this work. They have two ways of ascertaining this. They give people nuts to consume, and just before they're about to swallow, they have them spit out the nut, and they look at the particles. And some of the particles that they spit out are too large for the body to digest and assimilate in the brief span that those nuts are passing through the human GI tract. Another way that they do this is, you know, some people, unfortunately, they have what are called ostomy bags, where, you know, they, for whatever reason, they have to bypass the large intestine or the colon. And so they'll feed these patients, it's actually a great opportunity for research. They'll feed these patients whole nuts or other foods, and they see what comes out in the ostomy bag. And they found that that about 30% of the calories were still there after the foods have passed through the small intestine, which is where nutrient absorption happens. And so when you chew whole nuts, you're actually, or any whole food, there's a high likelihood that you're not extracting 100% of the calories of the foods that you're consuming. On the other hand, you're extracting 100% of the calories of ultra-processed foods. You're extracting 100% of the calories of even nut butters compared to whole nuts. So whole foods, I mean, that really is, I think, the primary takeaway. I mean, obviously there are certain foods that I love to talk about and I think are important to know about, but you can't beat whole foods, man. Another whole food that I'm a huge fan of, another food for flourishing, avocados. So I actually think of avocados as like the perfect brain health food because they're not just loaded with heart-healthy fats, like monounsaturated fat, but because they are so fatty, they're bound with fat-soluble antioxidants like vitamin E, like lutein and zeaxanthin, which I talked about earlier. They provide a ton of lutein and zeaxanthin, of vitamin E, super cardioprotective, and they've actually done clinical studies where they'll use avocados and compare it to other foods, trying to control for, you know, different nutrients that avocados contain. But they see that avocados actually can boost cognitive function, and they, you know, they have a very protective role to play. Another food that I think super underappreciated, mushrooms. Studies show that people who habitual mushroom consumers tend to have a reduced risk for the development of dementia, increased better immune function. Part of the reason for that is that mushrooms contain compounds called beta-glucans, which have been shown to have an immunomodulatory effect, so I'm a pretty big fan. They actually also, it's interesting, mushrooms are not plants. They're also not animals. They're of their own kingdom. And some of them produce powerful antioxidants that we produce in our own bodies, like glutathione, which is known as the mother of all antioxidants. So really, really wonderful food. Also low calorie, low carbohydrate, very satiating. Cruciferous vegetables. So I've just highlighted broccoli here, but you know, whatever your favorite cruciferous vegetable is, cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, arugula is a cruciferous vegetable. These are great. And they're distinct from dark leafy greens because they contain powerful pigments, they contain lutein, zeaxanthin, but cruciferous vegetables in particular, they contain compounds that support our body's detox pathways. So today, we are subject to exposure by any number of environmental pollutants. We live in a polluted world, whether it's carcinogens, whether we're talking endocrine disruptors, whether we are talking, I mean, you name it, lead in the dust from, you know, old homes that accumulate. They used to use lead in paint, which we breathe in subsequently, you know, when we're exposed to dust from old homes. Cruciferous vegetables contain compounds that directly support our body's detox pathways. And these compounds are actually, in a way, toxic. So many people now are on carnivore diets where they've eschewed these, you know, these kinds of produce. And lo and behold, the people that seem to derive benefit from carnivore diets are pretty unwell. But if you are already healthy, then you stand to derive real benefit from these kinds of compounds. And again, they help to stimulate our body's detox pathways by providing the precursor molecules to, you know, important antioxidants that we create in our own bodies, and by also stimulating those pathways. So wonderful, wonderful foods. Berries, another great food. We see that people who consume more berries, tend to have more youthful brains, and the dose is not even that large. We see that people who consume about a serving to two servings a week of berries tend to have improved cognitive function. There have been a number of studies with rats where they will give like berry extracts and see an improvement in the cognitive function of these rats. But lo and behold, blueberries, which I've highlighted here, they contain compounds called anthocyanins, the blue pigment. You also find them in purple potatoes and red onions, same compound. Those compounds accumulate in the memory center of the brain, the hippocampus, which is one of the first structures to be damaged in Alzheimer's disease. It's the region of the brain responsible for processing memory. And so we actually see that anthocyanins accumulate in the hippocampus, the memory center of the brain, and can protect it, which is great. Now, blueberries are just one berry. All berries have distinct and unique benefits to them. Strawberries are a great source of a compound called fisetin, which is known as a senolytic, actually can help reduce senescent cells in the body, which are thought of as like zombie cells that just sit around excreting inflammatory molecules and the like. So whatever your berry of choice is, fantastic foods. And that's it. Yeah. Thank you, guys. Yeah. Thank you. I want to take some questions. I love taking questions. And we've got a good amount of time, so I'm pumped. Just line up at the mics. But before we get to that, can I take a selfie with you guys? Amazing, 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 amazing. All right, so say cheese. Love it, nuts, yeah. You guys are crazy. That was fun, okay. All right, I love taking questions. And you know, I will just preface with, I don't know everything, but I'm gonna do my best to answer as many as I can, so. You guys are awesome. All right, so let's start over here and then we'll like ping pong, what do you say?
Hey Max, so Alzheimer's has oftentimes been referred to as type 3 diabetes, which suggests that insulin resistance has a strong role there. So I want to get your thoughts on the idea that whether or not is the single biggest thing a person can do to mitigate Alzheimer's is to maximize their insulin sensitivity and become as insulin sensitive as possible by optimizing their body composition, by having high muscle mass, low body fat.
Yeah, I mean, you answered your own question. you wanna optimize, you know, maximize your muscle mass for your genetic potential. A lot of people will now, there's a trend with regard to like micromanaging blood sugar, but I think it's important for people to realize that high blood sugar is a consequence of metabolic dysfunction. It's not necessarily the cause. So yeah, one of the best ways to promote whole body insulin sensitivity is to encourage the growth and maintenance of lean body mass, of muscle mass. For one, I mean, your muscles are a way to dispose of glucose. And so they're, you know, like, with regard to glucose storage in your body, our bodies are kind of like, you know, New York City studio apartments. There's just not a ton of room. And so by resistance training is one of the best ways to, you know, optimize whole body insulin sensitivity. And then again, focusing on the whole foods, you know, aspect of things. I mean, we're starting to see now that it's really the ultra processed foods. It's not necessarily carbs or fat, which I think many people have thought, you know, in the past, that drive insulin resistance so much as it is just the overabundance of these processed foods, which are just so aharmonious with the kinds of foods that our bodies actually know how to process. You know, they're just so aberrant in comparison to whole foods. So yeah, I mean, we see now that insulin sensitivity is really important, a really important disease-modifying characteristic. So the type 3 diabetes thing is really interesting. I'm working on a documentary, or I just finished a documentary about dementia prevention, and in it I've interviewed the the researcher who coined that term over at Brown University. And so, you know, we live in a time where 99.6% of Alzheimer's drug trials fail, and we're starting to see now new Alzheimer's drugs kind of come on the market, and they're really kind of like not that great. Maybe they're better than nothing, but you know, the etiology of Alzheimer's disease, meaning the cause of Alzheimer's disease, you know, it very well may be metabolic in origin, which is where resistance training, all the things that I've talked about, you know, make a huge difference. Hope that answers that.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you for the question.
Okay, so what is the better way to consume dark leafy greens, cooked or uncooked?
Great question. Dark leafy greens, you want a mix of raw and cooked. With raw, you know, like a food like kale. Kale is a cruciferous vegetable. You do derive a little bit of a benefit from consuming it raw, because some of these detox compounds, for example, that I was talking about earlier, are destroyed in the cooking process. A lot is conserved, you know, like the pigments are conserved, the vitamin C is conserved, but so you do want to have a mix, and you don't want to go overboard with any one food. You know, you don't want to overdo the kale. You don't want to. There's a famous case report in the medical literature of a woman in China who heard through the grapevine that bok choy is, you know, as a cruciferous vegetable, can help prevent type 2 diabetes. She started consuming 2 kilograms of raw bok choy every day. Poor woman grew a goiter the size of a basketball on the side of her neck. Yeah, so you don't wanna, you want dietary diversity. Super, super important, particularly with regard to these plant compounds. I'm less concerned about dietary diversity with regard to animal foods, but with plant compounds, you definitely wanna change it up and mix it up. Yeah, thank you.
Hi, Max. So I was raised on what I'd call a Garden of Eden premise. I was basically taught that literally the best food you can find is weeds foraged from the wilderness. And every time humans meddle in affairs and they process things, it basically makes food worse. Now, of course, I'm a capitalist, so I love industrial progress and technological innovation. But at times like this, I still get haunted by that Eden premise. So I was curious, do you think of industrially processed food as a bad thing that we never should have strayed into in the first place, or as a good thing that we just haven't figured out how to do properly yet?
Yeah, that's a fantastic question. It's you know, it's hard to hate against industrially processed food because, I mean, on the one hand, it's made food very safe, it's made food very accessible, it's made food very cheap, so there are benefits to it. Similarly with plastic, I mean, like, you know, there's now, we're starting to see a major health impact that the chronic and persistent exposure to plasticizing compounds is having on our health. They're made with endocrine disruptors like phthalates and bisphenol A, but it's impossible to argue that plastic hasn't made the world better. You know, I mean, try to be in medicine without utilizing plastic for its antiseptic and its, you know, I mean, all the wonderful properties of plastic. So there's a double-edged sword, I think, to everything. But it's just gone a little bit too far. It's become too convenient. It's become too palatable. It's become too cheap. And also, people tend to want quick fixes and easy, palatable calories, you know? So there is also a bit of, like, you know, there's also a bit of agency that people need to take for themselves. So I don't think it's like an easy, there's no easy answer, but I do think that over time, things are getting better. Like these, you know, you can now go to Walmart and find grass-fed beef and wild salmon and organic food, you know, and with greater consumer awareness, people, you know, these companies are starting to remove potentially damaging compounds from their, you know, from their products. So, yeah, I don't know. I mean, I'm definitely, you know, pro-capitalism as well, but, you know, and so I see the, like, if I was a food, you know, manufacturer, I would want my food products to be delicious and to yield nice profits and, you know, to create repeat customers. But I think as long as, you know, we educate ourselves and our loved ones, it's balanced. It's not that you can't ever have your favorite ultra-processed indulgence ever again, but we tend to over-rely on these foods now. And part of it has to do with the fact that we, you know, many of us are lazy, or we don't live in environments where we have access to healthful food. So, yeah, it's complicated.
Thank you.
But thank you for the question.
In the presentation, I saw many of the studies were about correlation and not causation. That's like a problem of food science in general. And I'm curious, could you provide some details about the mechanism, how highly processed food is damaging the health? Because like obviously persons who are obese tend to buy a frozen pizza or something, but that's not necessarily the reason why they're obese, because they do not make like sport activities or go to, or stop smoking or something. So I'm curious, how does it work? What's the problem with highly processed food?
Great question. Yes. So a lot of the nutrition research, it's not like a hard science. It's not like physics. It's, you know, we have the data is all pretty weak unless you have RCTs, long-term randomized controlled trials. But you know, we just don't. Nutrition research is harder to study than drugs, and it's vastly less well-funded. So a lot of the studies that we have are cheaply, you know, they're done kind of bootstrapped, for lack of a better term. And so that's kind of, you know, what we're left with is this epidemiologic data. But there are compelling mechanisms which might explain the associations that we see with ultra-processed foods and poor disease health outcomes. So for one, it goes back to the food matrix, which, you know, increases the disruption of the food matrix, potentially can increase a metric known as eating rate. So we actually eat these, we can eat these foods faster. They're much easier to chew, to masticate. And we see that when we slow down when we eat, we experience greater satiety, because it takes a while for our stomachs to register and our brains to register that we've got food in our stomachs. So eating rate is increased, the more processed a food is. Obviously, ultra-processed foods are gonna have more additives and chemicals in it that we, you know, maybe don't have as much data, or potentially even can have a harmful effect or a pro-inflammatory effect. They're extremely calorie dense. They're minimally satiating. So this was shown actually in a RCT by one of the preeminent obesity researchers named Kevin Hall, who gave a group, NIH-funded study, they gave a group ultra-processed foods as their sole diet, and they crossed them over after a number of weeks to a whole foods diet. And they found that when eating to the same degree of satiety, the ultra-processed foods led to overconsumption by about 500 calories. Meaning, by the time you've consumed ultra-processed foods to satiety, you've already overconsumed them. Whereas due to the satiety effect, the fact that they're less calorie dense, the whole foods, when eaten to the same degree of satiety, meaning the same degree of like, I've had enough, I'm good, I'm gonna push myself away from the table now, they came in effortlessly at a calorie deficit. So right there we see the satiety aspect. You know, ultra-processed foods might directly be contributing to the obesity epidemic because of the lack of, you know, the attenuated satiety effect that we get from them. They lack fiber. They tend to be depleted of hydration, because hydration, water, is one of the quickest ways to reduce a food's shelf life. So ultra-processed foods are dehydrated, they don't have fiber, and they're also, importantly, last but not least, they're diluted of protein. And protein is the most satiating of the macronutrients. So when I say macronutrients, we've got carbs, protein, and fat. Protein is the most satiating. So if you're hungry, eat protein, you tend to consume fewer calories. Protein is expensive. So ultra-processed food manufacturers, they deplete, you know, these foods of protein. They tend to be some combination of carbs and fat. It's not necessarily that they're all carbs. It's usually a combination of carbs and fat that make them hyperpalatable and, you know, make us eat more of them. So there are some really, you know, some really well-defined mechanisms that might explain those observations. Great question. Thank you.
Hi, thank you for being so specific and clear in all of this. That was an awesome talk to listen to, definitely learned a lot.
Thank you.
I have a question that I'm not entirely sure is gonna be your wheelhouse or you'll have advice for it, but I'm gonna try. I was wondering, do you have any suggestions on how to make it easy to make it a part of your lifestyle to eat more healthy foods and good brain foods for especially like the exhausted and broke college student, the starving artist, the single mother, the depressed young adult living in their apartment for the first time? Not that I'm speaking from experience, but just any ways to kind of make those lifestyle changes? And then kind of a second scientific question slid under the door here. Are there any supplements like protein bars or things that are easily consumable, and then also caffeine, some of these kind of like life hacks? How do you feel about those nutritionally?
Yeah, great questions. Well, I'm a huge fan of, so let's tackle the budget aspect of things first. Frozen vegetables are great, super economical, and as much as I advocate for, you know, ethical omnivory and the consumption of grass-fed, grass-finished beef, lean red meat, even if industrially raised, is still a better option for dinner than some ultra-processed, you know, say boxed mac and cheese. So I'm a huge fan of, I think, you know, red meat is a health food, and it's unfortunate that it continues to be so, you know, highly demonized. Eggs are highly economical. You know, there's a continuum. We can't let perfect be the enemy of the good. So, I mean, even though pastured eggs, I think, are better for, you know, the chickens, leads to happier chickens, better for the environment, conventional eggs are phenomenal. And organic, like, I'm not... Organic is a buzz phrase that, you know, I think is important from an environmental standpoint, but you don't even have to, you know, like, if that's off limits to you, then don't buy organic, you know? Particularly, I mean, I don't buy organic when I'm buying produce where I'm not eating the skin or the peel. So, yeah, and meal prep is also a great way to economize. I mean, I do that myself too, just because it's so convenient. And then buying in bulk. Finally. And learning it. So buying in bulk is great. Costco, you know, we now have like a number of like these mail order systems, which are great, where you can order, you know, en masse. And then also learning how to cook. So learning how to cook, you know, educating yourself. I feel like one of the major problems with society today is that we tend to outsource expertise. You know, one of our hunter-gatherer ancestors had to have been self-sufficient. And today we live in the era of specialization, and I think many of us are suffering for it. We outsource financial literacy, we outsource culinary literacy, right? I mean, with a few swipes on our smartphone today, we can get, like, whatever it is that we can dream of food-wise at our doorsteps in 15 minutes. And we outsource health literacy, right? Like, I go to the doctor to tell me how to, like, be healthy. That's not, I don't think that that's cool. And so anyway, culinary literacy is important because, you know, you can buy really cheap, for example, cuts of meat that, if you just knew how to cook, come out delicious. You know, like, for example, flank steak is something that I've become obsessed with lately. Most people don't buy it because it's tough. But if you know how to cook it, and you know how to cut it, more specifically, against the grain, it's amazing. It's so good. So arming yourself with a little bit of education. And then when it comes to supplements, I'm a huge fan of protein powder. Huge fan. Whey protein is my go-to. Much more so than protein bars. Protein bars tend to be kind of like slightly better for you candy bars. But protein powder tends to be very cheap and a great food. It is processed. I wouldn't call it ultra processed. It is processed. But I'm doing protein shakes at least once a day, typically. So, yeah.
Thank
Hope that
so
answers
much.
That. Thank you. We've got about 10 minutes left.
Thank you. That was a great talk. So my wife, who's sitting right there, she's doing her master's in nutrition right now.
Love it.
And so I'm hearing a lot of the things that you were talking about today over and over again. So my question is both nutrition related, but also marriage counseling. So my question is, after you get past the 0.7 grams of protein per pound, my understanding is that your body can convert that to sugar. The protein to sugar, you can also urinate it out, and so I'm wondering how much, you know, if I'm trying to top out my protein intake, how much do I have to be concerned about converting the protein to sugar once I get past that point?
Not at all. Don't be concerned about that at all. That's a demand-driven process, and protein, because it's so satiating, it provides other benefits, you know, in terms of appetite regulation. So don't worry about it converting to sugar. That's putting the cart before the horse and splitting hairs. Just optimize your protein, and if you still struggle with hunger, try to eat even more. It's self-limiting. So the idea of eating too much protein, it's not It's something that in practice isn't even very likely to happen because of how satiating it is.
And let's say, because I know what she's going to say, and so let's say that you're getting a significant part of that protein intake through whey protein, which is less satiating. Yeah, so you could theoretically.
Yeah, well, I mean, if you're consuming that much whey, well, there's no need to consume that much whey protein. That's a supplement. So I'd rather see you get your protein from whole foods and use that as a supplement. But no, I mean, for people with healthy kidneys, there's that whole myth about protein being harmful to healthy kidney function has been, there's no evidence that that is in fact the case. For people with damaged kidneys, kidney disease, that's a different story. But yeah, I would not be concerned, you know, and I would really try to optimize it. Also, people like bodybuilders eat even higher levels of protein when they're cutting down for competitions because it helps you maintain your lean mass. So it's a really powerful, it's almost like magic. It's a very powerful variable. And people that under consume less protein tend to consume more carbs and fat, which, you know, we tend to over consume. I mean, that's one of the defining aspects of the standard American diet.
Thank you.
Welcome. Thank you.
Do you think there is a trade-off between longevity and performance? So what seems best for longevity is calorie restriction. Sugar is good for endurance events. Carnivores say they feel really good, maybe to the detriment of longevity. Do you think there is a trade-off there?
That's a great question. So is there a trade-off between longevity and performance? Like if we're optimizing for how we feel and body composition, are we, you know, cutting potentially months, years off our lives at the other end of the spectrum? First off, a lot of the calorie restriction data has been misinterpreted. So they're very careful to use the term calorie restriction in these mice studies where they show that restricting a mouse of calories actually leads to a lifespan, an increase in lifespan. And what they're doing is they're restricting calories, but the mice are not necessarily in a calorie deficit. They're just not allowing the mice who would otherwise overeat to a point of being overweight or obese to overeat. So for a human, I think that the extrapolation is to simply not overconsume food, is to have a healthy body composition, replete with lean mass, muscle mass, and the like. And I don't think that then you would see a decrement in your longevity, you know, if optimizing for lean mass.
Sure.
In the mouse studies, they're restricting their calories because a mouse will just eat and eat and eat to a point of obesity. So I'm not a fan of calorie restriction. I mean, if you were persistently to be in a calorie deficit, you would die over time. So not, I think, the way to longevity, in my view. Thank you for the question.
Cheers.
We've got 5 minutes left. I wish we had more, but maybe we got time for, two more.
Several of my questions have already been answered, but one I just thought of on the spot. I have a question about fasting as far as like 24 hours and beyond, maybe even multi-day fasts. Do you have any views or thoughts on longer multi-day fasting?
Would not do it. Would not do it because of the potential loss in lean mass that would occur. And there's also no real benefit to do it. I mean, autophagy is now a buzzword online, which is, you know, a sort of cellular house cleaning mechanism. But we have no way of measuring it. It's an interesting mechanism that I think, you know, health and wellness influencers have, like, taken and ran with. I don't see any benefit of extended fasting. I don't. I mean, I think, you know, if it depends on what your... I'd be interested to know what your goals were and why that is something that you'd be potentially interested in to find something that's a little bit more balanced and sustainable for you.
Okay, so, but autophagy is something that's, we just don't have a lot of evidence or science to...
No, it just, autophagy happens when you're exercising, it happens when you're sleeping, you know. So, I mean, I think it's great, you know, I think it's a nice balance to not eat for the entire 16 hours that I'm awake and instead, you know, maybe eat like within a 12-hour window to just kind of enhance that a little bit. But you know, it's a hypothetical. We have no way of measuring it. And it happens when we exercise. It happens when we're in a calorie deficit. It happens, you know, when we're sleeping. So it's already happening. It's already happening. This idea that we need to like increase it, I think, is just kind of like marketing. It's like, you know, people that are like trying to sell you autophagy online are usually trying to sell you something also, other than autophagy.
So you don't really need to plan on it.
Don't what?
You shouldn't expect to plan on it. Like it's a...
No, I'm not. I mean, my favorite form of intermittent fasting is being referred to as time-restricted eating. So it's like not eating too close to your bedtime, because that kind of honors our circadian inclinations as diurnal creatures to eat during the day, when our metabolisms are most sort of primed to assimilate, metabolize, store food and nutrients. So time-restricted eating would be my go-to. But extended fasts, I don't see any real benefit.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. All right, we got time for one more.
All right. Hello, I'm from Ujatael, and my question is, part of our population don't eat a lot of ultra-processed food because they just want, for example, in their jobs, they don't have time to cook, make a meal with eggs and rice. So their only option, most part of time, is to eat a burger with French fries and get back to their job. So what would you suggest to these persons, including me, to introduce more healthy food in their diet?
Somebody who's very strapped for time. Yeah, I mean, a lot of fast food places can be tweaked, to be made healthy. You can find salads at most fast food places, and I would add burger patties to that. You know, I would buy burger patties without the bun and add that to a salad. I travel a lot, and you know, even when I'm on the road, I find that at gas stations you can often find a can of tuna. You know, I was at a gas station the other day and I found a can of or a package of bumblebee tuna with a buffalo wing sauce in it. And I was like, you know, the 12-year-old in me was like, I'm buying that. I bought it, and it was pretty good. You know, it was like lean, great source of protein. So beef jerky, you could find that at most gas stations. You know, I mean, I think about what kind of food can you find realistically at a gas station? Most gas stations have canned tuna, great protein source. You can sometimes find in the refrigerated section hard-boiled eggs, you know? I mean, these aren't the best possible options, but you know, if you're really dedicated and in a pinch, there's a lot out there that you can do. I just think it's important to be able to identify whole foods and to also become familiar with the nutrition facts labels on foods. That really helps as well. So.
All right, thank you.
Thank you for the question. Thank you guys so much. Thank you guys. Thank you.